Students, today we are going to discuss about gravitation. We are going to list out Newton's law of gravitation, acceleration due to gravity, and gravity at a particular height, gravity, variation of gravity with depth, then value of acceleration due to gravity with latitude, variation of g with latitude. And then further we are going to speak about gravitational field intensity, gravitational potential comparisons, and then gravitational potential energy, and then we are going to speak about the escape velocity and orbital velocities, and then period of revolution of satellites, etc. in this particular chapter. The very basic fundamental is the Newton's laws in explaining gravitation. Newton's law of gravitation states that every particle or every object in the universe attracts every other object, which is directly proportional to the product of their masses and inversely proportional to square of the distance between them. So I can write F is proportional to m1 m2 and inversely proportional to r square. So F proportional to m1 m2 divided by r square. Proportionality constant is g, which is m1 m2 divided by r square. The value of g is 6.67 into 10 power minus 11 newton meter square, kilogram power minus 2. Right. The unit of Newton's gravitational constant is newton meter square, kilogram power minus 2. We can say here this gravitational force is independent of the medium in between the two masses. In case of electrostatics or in magnetostatics, the force between two charges or force between two poles depends upon the medium also, medium in which the charges and the poles are placed. Whereas in case of gravitation, if a force is acting between two masses having magnitude m1 and m2, if any medium comes in between these two masses, the force do not change. The force is independent of the medium between the two masses. So F is equal to g m1 m2 divided by r square. Force is medium independent, and force is also independent of, force between two masses is independent of the presence of other masses. If suppose I have a mass m1 and another mass m2 over here, they are separated by distance r. Another mass m3 is somewhere over a distance r1 from m1 and r2 from m2. This mass will not disturb the force between these masses m1 and m2. The presence of other masses will not disturb the force between the two masses m1 and m2. So the force between the two masses is independent of the presence of other masses. So superposition principle is valid. Superposition of forces between these masses is valid. So m3 will exert a force on m1, m1 or m2 will exert a force on m1. Total force on M1 can be calculated as F vector equals F1 vector plus F2 vector. So superposition principle is valid. I can write F vector equals F1 vector plus F2 vector. Superposition principle is also valid. Now, this is about the forces, but there are a large number of forces which are existing with this formula. F proportional to m1 m2 by r square. They will ask you, if the masses are doubled, distance of separation is also doubled, what is the force between the two masses? If masses are doubled, 2 into 2, 4. If the distance of separation is also doubled, 2 square is 4. So force remains same in this way. They will speak about the masses, they will speak about the distance of separation between the two masses, and then they will ask you to calculate the forces. This is a fundamental problem which is existing in Newton's law of gravitation. There are a lot many number of problems. They will be giving you system of charges, system of masses, and they will ask you to calculate the force acting on a particular mass m1. We can go on with that also. We will see the examples later. Now, what is the formula for the value of acceleration due to gravity? We can go on to the next one. Acceleration due to gravity. Acceleration due to gravity. Gravity is the force of attraction exerted by Earth on other masses or other objects. gravity is the force of attraction exerted by earth on other masses. If the body is accelerated by this force, then it is called acceleration due to gravity. From the statements itself, we can bring out the expression for the value of acceleration due to gravity. Value of acceleration due to gravity is represented by a small letter g. We can write here, the force of Newton's law of gravitation states that F is equal to g me m divided by r e square, where me is the mass of earth, r e is the radius of earth. Let us say a small mass be placed over the surface of earth, then the force exerted by the earth on this mass m is F is equal to g me m divided by r square. In this particular case, we have to say the entire mass of the earth is assumed to be concentrated at its center. This entire spherical mass, earth mass, is acting or behaving as a point mass at its center. So the entire mass is focused at the center of the earth. In this mass and this mass m are separated by distance r e, then a force is said to be acting between the two masses, which is given by the expression F is equal to g m e m divided by r e square. If we need to calculate the value of gravity, F is equal to mg. G equals F by m. So this is g me m divided by r e square into m. So g equals g me divided by r e square. So we can have this expression g me is equal to g r e square. Often we will use this expression g me is equal to g r e square. This is the expression for the value of acceleration due to gravity, g equals g me divided by r e square. Right? Now, we can go on calculating the value of the variation of value of acceleration due to gravity with the increase in altitude as well as with the increase in depth. In order to speak about the value of g with altitude, we can take it as h. Let us consider the earth, which has a mass m e, its radius is r e. A mass small m is placed at a height h above the earth's surface. We have to calculate the value of acceleration due to gravity at this particular point where the mass m is at a height h. So to calculate, once again you have to follow the same procedure. First you have to speak about the Newton's law of gravitation, where the force between the two masses must be calculated, from which we have to calculate the value of acceleration due to gravity g. Now we can just go on. The, as I mentioned earlier, the entire mass of the earth, for spherical bodies, the entire mass is assumed to be concentrated at its center. So we can say the entire mass is at its center, this mass is m, the total separation between the two masses is r e plus h. R e plus h. So how will you write the force between the two masses? F is equal to g m e small m divided by r e plus h the whole square. R e plus h the whole square. Now the value of acceleration due to gravity can be calculated g prime, because g is the value of acceleration due to gravity due to earth. The same value of acceleration due to gravity is going to be discussed here, but thing is that this is for the object placed over the surface. If the object is at certain height h, then we can go for g prime. G prime is equal to the same F divided by m, which is g m e m divided by r e plus h the whole square into m. This m gets cancels out. So you will have g m e divided by, I can take out r e square out. So this will become 1 plus h by r e the whole square. G prime is equal to, what is gme? G r e square. So we can replace that gme as g r e square. G equals gme divided by r e square. So instead of this gme divided by r e square, I can write g. So g prime is equal to g divided by 1 plus h by r e the whole square. When taken up, g 1 plus h by r e the whole power minus 2. We are applying binomial theorem on neglecting higher powers. We can write g prime. We can write g prime is equal to g into 1 minus of 2h divided by re. This is the expression for the value of acceleration due to gravity at a particular height h with altitude. So what will happen if h increases, the value of g decreases. So g decreases or g prime decreases with altitude. G prime decreases with altitude, right? G prime equals g into 1 minus of 2h by re. Now, if this re plus h is taken to be small r, this is also re. Re plus h is taken to be small r, then this expression, we can write this as 1. This expression g prime can be written as g prime equals gme divided by r square. So I can write g prime is inversely proportional to r square. G prime varies inversely with r square. So as r increases from the center of the earth, the value of g prime decreases. Right? This is about the value of the variation of acceleration due to gravity with altitude. Then we can calculate the variation of value of acceleration due to gravity with depth. Right? Fine. Value of variation of acceleration due to gravity with the depth. For our convenience, I can take same h for depth. Let us consider the earth surface from where I am going to consider the mass m, which is placed at a distance re. This distance is h, this one is re minus h. So a mass m is placed at certain depth h inside the earth. What will be the value of acceleration due to gravity over the mass m due to this depth? In the initial cases, we wrote the mass of the earth as me. Now, this portion, the shaded portion of the earth alone, is going to exert a force on this mass smaller. So what will happen? This mass will not be the same as me. Mass will be changing. I can mark this mass as m prime. How will I calculate the mass of this particular portion having a distance or radius re minus h? We can calculate. Mass m prime is equal to density into v prime. Density is mass by volume. So mass divided by the entire volume of the earth can be taken as 4 by 3 pi re cube. Because re is the radius of the earth. M by 4 by 3 pi re cube into v prime. V prime is the volume of this smaller sphere. So I can write 4 by 3 pi re minus of h the whole cube. Re minus h the whole cube. This 4 pi by 3 gets cancels out. So this will be m by re cube into re minus of h the whole cube. This is m prime. Now, in order to calculate the force, I have to write f is equal to g m prime small m divided by re minus of h the whole square. Do you understand how this expression comes? F is equal to g m prime, because this mass is m prime, its entire mass is assumed to be concentrated at its center, mass small m is placed over its surface, so g m prime m divided by re minus h the whole square. Substitute for m. Let us consider this as 1 and this one as 2. So we can write f is equal to g m prime is m into re minus of h the whole cube divided by re cube into re minus of h the whole square into small m. This cube, this square gets cancels out. That should be right. Should go on to the next step. Re minus of H into M divided by Re cube. Now, in order to calculate the value of acceleration due to gravity g prime with depth, I can write g prime is equal to F divided by M, and this is equal to gm into Re minus of H divided by Re cube. As you know, gm by Re square is equal to small g. So gm by Re square into Re minus of H divided by Re. I have just split up this Re cube into Re square into Re. What is this gm by Re square? G. So g into Re minus of H divided by Re, which can be represented as g into 1 minus of H divided by Re. This is the expression for the variation of value of acceleration due to gravity with the depth, g into 1 minus of H divided by Re. From this expression also, we can say as the value of depth H increases, the value of g prime decreases. So as you move above the earth surface or as you go deep inside the earth surface, the value of acceleration due to gravity decreases. Now, we can just make some assumption here. What is this R minus H? I can choose this expression. G prime is equal to gm into Re minus of H divided by Re cube. You might have studied in 10th standard that what will be the value of acceleration due to gravity at the center of the earth. At the center of the earth, H will be equal to R. H will be equal to R. So what will happen? H and R will be equal. So this difference will become zero. So the entire term goes as zero. So G prime is zero. At the center of earth, the value of acceleration due to gravity is zero. So g prime is equal to gm into Re minus of H divided by Re cube. If I consider small r is equal to Re minus of H, then this expression will become g prime is equal to gm r divided by Re cube. From this expression, I can write g prime is proportional to r. G prime is proportional to r. Now, we can draw a graph with the for the value of acceleration due to gravity with respect to R. As we move from center to the surface and then above the surface, what will happen? So we can take G prime along Y axis, R along X axis. This is capital R, which is equal to radius. R equals capital R. Up to R, the value of acceleration due to gravity varies directly with respect to R. This is what we have obtained. G prime is proportional to R. We are starting from the center of the earth and you are moving towards the surface. As R increases up to the surface of earth, the value of G prime increases because G prime is directly proportional to R. So it's a straight line. And then as you move above the earth surface, the value of G prime varies inversely with R square. As g varies inversely with r square, you will get a hyperbola. So g varies inversely with r square. So this is the graphical representation for the variation of acceleration due to gravity with respect to distance. The variation of g with latitude. How the value of, just write down the thing, g with the latitude. How the value of g varies with the latitude, that can be discussed here. Earth is said to be rotating about its own axis from west to east. So each and every particle over the surface of Earth will also undergo a rotational motion. If this is the axis about which the Earth is rotating, I am assuming a mass small m over here, which is at an angle phi with respect to the horizontal. Now, this particle will also undergo a circular motion with a radius smaller. R is the radius of the earth, that is different. this r is small r, which is the radius of the circular path possessed by the mass m. If the earth spins, the particle over the surface will also undergo a circular motion about the same axis but with a different radius. Right? If this is phi, this angle is also phi. Whenever we speak about rotational motion, we have to speak about pseudo forces. Pseudo forces are nothing but false forces which will exist only when you speak about the rotational motion. Right? A centrifugal force, mr omega square, will be acting in the upward direction. If this angle is phi, then this is 180 minus of phi. We have to calculate once again the force, net force acting on the mass m, and then from which we are going to calculate the value of acceleration due to gravity. The net force acting on the mass m can be expressed as f is equal to square root of mg the whole square plus mr omega square the whole square plus 2 mg mr omega square cos phi. We can write cos of 180 minus phi. Cos of 180 minus phi. So I can write square root of mg the whole square plus mr omega square the whole square plus 2 mg mr omega square cos of 180 minus phi minus cos phi. So I can make it as minus of cos phi minus cos phi. If mass is taken out of this expression, then f is equal to m into square root of g square plus r square omega power 4 minus of 2 g r omega square cos phi. Value of acceleration due to gravity with respect to latitude g prime can be calculated as once again g prime equals f divided by m. If you look at all the expressions, they are all following the same format. First you have to calculate the force, then you have to write the expression g equals f by m, from which you can calculate the value of acceleration due to gravity. G prime equals f divided by m, which is equal to square root of g square plus r square omega power 4 minus of 2 g r omega square cos phi, where r square omega power 4, as omega is very small, r square omega power 4 is negligible. So we are going to neglect from this expression. Also, what is the value of small r here? Small r is equal to r into cos phi from this one. If this is r e, then this is also r e, radius r e. If I resolve this into two components, this vector is making an angle phi with this horizontal. So this will be the cos component, r e cos phi. This one will be r e sin phi. So r e cos phi component is equal to r, small r. So small r is taken as r cos phi. G prime can be represented as square root of g square minus of 2 g. Instead of small r, I can substitute capital R cos phi. Already a cos phi is there, so cos square phi. So omega square cos square phi. Omega square cos square phi. G prime is equal to, G is taken out from this expression, so that you will have 1 minus of 2 R omega square cos square phi divided by G the whole power 1 by 2. Whole power 1 by 2. Now, applying binomial theorem and neglecting higher powers, you will have g prime is equal to g into 1 minus of 1 by 2, this 2 gets cancels out, r omega square cos square phi divided by g. As you take g inside, you will have g prime equals g minus of r omega square cos square phi, where phi is the latitude angle, or phi is the latitude angle. Depending upon the value of phi, the value of g will be changing. If it is for equator, the value of phi is 0. For equator, the value of phi is equal to 0. Then g prime will be equal to cos 0 is 1. So g minus of r omega square. at poles phi equals 90 degree, cos 90 is 0, entire term goes 0, so g prime is equal to g. G prime is equal to g. This is how the variation of value of acceleration due to gravity with the latitude takes place. Right? For a quarter, phi equals 0. At poles, phi equals 90 degrees, so g prime is equal to g. This is how the expression comes. Suppose if some other angle is given, latitude angle is given, 45 degree for example. Cos 45 is 1 by root 2. So cos square, phi is there. So 1 by 2. G prime equals g minus of r omega square by 2. Right? You can calculate the value of g prime by knowing the value of latitude angle. Right? Now we shall compare the intensity of gravitational field and the gravitational potential. The expression for gravitational field, as you know, gravitational field is the field around the earth where its influence is felt. Gravitational potential is nothing but the amount of work done in moving unit mass from infinity to that particular point. Both are given by the expression Z vector equals F vector divided by M. Its unit is Newton per kilogram. And the gravitational potential is V equals W by M, work done divided by unit mass. Its unit is joule per kilogram. We are going to speak about the electric field intensity and gravitational potential for different masses. If it is for a point mass, the value of gravitational field intensity is E equals gm divided by r square. Gravitational potential is V equals minus of gm by r. If it is for a solid sphere, then we have to speak about two different points. This is considered to be a solid sphere of radius r. You are assuming two points A and B. At any external point where r is greater than or equal to capital R, E equals gm by r square, the same expression retains. So E is inversely proportional to r square. At any internal point, r is less than or equal to r, r is less than or equal to r, E equals gm r divided by r cube, by proof, gm r divided by r cube. Here, the gravitational field intensity is E is proportional to small r. E is proportional to small r. In this particular case, actually, this is the expression which we obtain by considering this mass alone. The shaded, dotted circle is there. No? This mass. This mass must be considered, with which we have to calculate the force, and then from which we have to calculate the gravitational field intensity. As you do so, you will get gmr divided by r cube, where E is directly proportional to small r. This is about the gravitational field intensity. Gravitational potential for the same solid sphere at any external point r greater than or equal to capital R, V equals minus of gm by r. Same expression will come here also. At any internal point r less than or equal to capital R, gravitational potential V equals minus of gm divided by 2r cube into 3r square minus of small r square. Minus of gm, 3r square minus of small r square divided by 2r cube. If you consider the gravitational potential at the center of the earth, then we can say at center of the solid sphere, then we can say r is equal to 0. If this r becomes 0, this expression goes as vo equals minus of 3 by 2 gm by r. If it is on the surface, let us consider the surface to be C, somewhere on the surface. Then small r is equal to capital R, then Vc is equal to minus of gm by r. If you substitute small r equals capital R, 3r square minus of r square will become 2r square. 2r square, 2r square goes off, simply you will have minus of gm by r. For this, we can draw a graph. Gravitational field intensity versus distance. Gravitational field intensity varies directly as r up to the radius of the sphere. Above the sphere or outside the sphere, the gravitational field intensity decreases, and it varies inversely with r square. Gravitational potential with respect to distance. Gravitational potential is minus of 3 by 2 gm by r, which is exactly at the center. At a distance r equals capital R, the gravitational potential is minus of gm divided by r. This is for solid spheres. This is for solid spheres. This expression might be a new one for you. Then, due to a spherical shell, this is similar to that of the electric field intensity due to charged spherical shell, and the gravitational potential due to a charged spherical shell, same as that. Due to a spherical shell, at any external point, r greater than or equal to capital R, E equals gm by r square. If you look at the expression, all these expressions are similar. Due to point mass, E equals gm by r square. Due to a solid sphere, E equals gm divided by r square. Due to a spherical shell, at any external point, E equals gm by r square. At any internal point, r less than or equal to capital R is equal to 0. Gravitational field intensity do not exist inside the spherical shell. If it is for gravitational potential due to a spherical shell, at any external point, r greater than or equal to capital R, V equals minus of gm by r, where V is inversely proportional to r. At any internal point, r less than or equal to capital R, V equals minus of gm by capital R, which means the potential at any point inside the spherical shell is same as that on the surface. Surface is equal is to have a radius R. So the potential, gravitational potential, is constant throughout the sphere. If you consider a sphere, it has a radius R. If a potential is assumed at its surface, then the potential at the center, potential at some point VA, potential at some point VB, whatever it is, the potential will be same throughout. Potential will be same throughout. So potential is constant inside the sphere. For these two cases, we can draw a graph. The gravitational field intensity versus distance graph is like this. Up to R, there is no gravitational field intensity. At R, it's maximum gm by R square. And as R increases further, the value of gravitational field intensity decreases. In case of gravitational potential, up to R, the value of gravitational potential is constant. Beyond R, the value of gravitational potential decreases. About the field due to a uniform circular ring at a point on its axis and the gravitational potential at a point P along the axis of the ring. The field on the axis of the ring at a distance R from the center is E equals gm r divided by r square plus r small r square, the whole power 3 by 2. E is maximum when dE by dr is equal to 0. If you look at the graph, we can identify that. When you draw a graph by taking small r with respect to E, the graph varies like this, and its maximum is at a distance r by root 2. E maximum is at a distance r by root 2. At this point, the slope will be equal to 0. dE by dr will be equal to 0. Slope is 0, E is maximum, R is equal to R by root. So E maximum will be equal to 2 gm divided by 3 root 3 R square. E maximum equals 2 gm divided by 3 root 3 R square. This is for a circular ring. If we calculate the gravitational potential at the same point on the axis of a circular ring, V equals minus of gm by square root of R square plus small r square. At this point, the gravitational potential is minus of gm divided by square root of r square plus small r square. At the center r equals 0, vo equals minus of gm by r. If r equals 0, vo equals minus of gm by square root of r square will become r. The graphical variation for the gravitational field intensity due to a circular ring of mass m and the gravitational potential for the circular ring of mass capital M can be shown like this. This is the variation of gravitational field intensity with respect to R. Its maximum is at a distance R by root 2. R by root 2. Maximum value of gravitational field intensity is 2 gm by 3 root 3 R square. Gravitational potential varies like this on either side of the ring. You can see here. At the center, the gravitational field intensity is maximum. Gravitational potential is maximum. At the center, gravitational potential is maximum. As you go towards the positive side, potential decreases. As you go towards negative side, potential decreases. Right? Think about the relation between gravitational field intensity E and the gravitational potential V. Gravitational field intensity and gravitational potential are related as dV equals minus of E vector dot dr vector. This is from the expression E vector equals dv divided by dr minus of dv divided by dr. Gravitational potential or gravitational field intensity is negative gradient of gravitational potential. If E vector is equal to Exi cap plus Eyj cap plus Ezk cap, and dr vector is equal to Xi cap plus Yj cap plus Zk cap, then dv will be equal to minus of Ex dx, minus of Ey dy, and minus of Ez dz. If you are calculating the gravitational potential along the x direction, then dy and dz must be considered to be zero. If you are speaking about the gravitational potential along the y direction, dx and dz is considered to be zero. Along the z direction, then dx and dy are considered to be zero. So separately, if you want to calculate or if you want to write the gravitational field intensity along the x direction, Ex equals minus of dou v divided by dou x. Similarly, you can write Ey equals minus of dou v divided by dou y, and the Ez is equal to minus of dou v divided by dou z. Partial derivatives of the gravitational potential along the x, y and z directions. Now, the total electric field intensity E vector is equal to Exi cap plus Eyj cap plus Ezk cap. Magnitude of the gravitational field intensity, square root of Ex square plus Ey square plus Ez square, right? By calculating, if you know the value of a gravitational potential, you have to go on with the differentiation, and then you have to calculate the gravitational field intensities respectively along the x, y and z directions. Then if you want to write the vector form of the gravitational field intensity, then this is the way: E equals Exi cap plus Eyj cap plus Ezk cap. The magnitude of gravitational field intensity is modulus of E vector equals square root of Ex square plus Ey square plus Ez square. If potential is known, field can be calculated. In the same way, if field is known, potential can also be calculated. How will you calculate potential? It is very simple. We have, let us say you are moving mass from distance r1 to r2. You know, you are asked to calculate the potential difference between the two points in the gravitational field. That can be calculated by V r2 vector minus of V r1 vector is equal to minus of integral r1 to r2 E vector dot dr vector. E vector dot dr vector. So V r2 vector minus of V r1 vector equals minus of integral r1 to r2 E vector dot dr vector. And what is this minus of integral r1 to r2 E vector dot dr vector? This is nothing but work done. You can write it as minus of W. So gravitational potential difference is equal to negative of work done. Gravitational potential difference is equal to negative of work done. V of r2 vector minus of V of r1 vector is equal to minus of W. Right? This is about the relation between gravitational field intensity and gravitational potential. We can solve some simple examples related to this one. Right? Then we shall go on to the next one, gravitational potential energy. We used to call GPE, gravitational potential energy. Gravitational potential energy is very simple. It is the amount of work done in bringing the masses from different locations to the specified points. The amount of work done determines the potential energy between the masses. If we consider two point masses, they are kept separated by a distance, let us say r, then the gravitational potential energy between these two masses can be given as U equals minus of g m1 m2 divided by r. U equals minus of g m1 m2 divided by r. Actually, I have to speak about the potential energy difference, but I am considering one reference point, one point as the reference point which is at infinity, and another point is the point where the mass m2 has been brought. So the gravitational potential energy is given by U equals minus of g m1 m2 divided by r. This is for two point masses. In the same way, we can go on with by calculating the gravitational potential energy for system of masses. For n number of point masses, there is an expression to calculate, or there is a simple formula to calculate how many number of possible potential energies that must be summed up. If suppose the system contains n number of masses, then the total number of potential energies that must be summed up to get total potential energy is given by n into n minus 1 divided by 2. N into n minus 1 divided by 2. For example, if you consider a equilateral triangle where at the apex there are three masses, equal masses, which are placed. I am considering the sides as our equilateral triangle. For our convenience, how many masses are there? This is the mass distribution. How many masses are there? Three masses. So, total number of potential energies that must be calculated and summed up is 3 into 3 minus 1 divided by 2. This gets cancelled out. So, this is 3. So, potential energy between these two masses and these two masses. Total potential energy can now be written as U equals U1 plus U2 plus U3. This is minus of G M square divided by R square plus of, or I can take minus of G M square divided by R square minus of G M square divided by R square. Totally, I can write minus of G M square divided by, R. These are all R. Minus of Gm square by R into 3. This will give you the total potential energy. Minus of Gm square divided by R into 3. The same way we can calculate the gravitational potential energy for 4 point masses. Masses are placed at the corners of a square. Sides are taken to be small r. Then, how many number of possible potential energies that must be summed up here? 4 masses are there. So 4 minus 1 divided by 2, this gets cancels out. 4 minus 1 is 3, so totally 6. So 6 potential energies must be summed up. 4 potential energies that are along the sides of the square. 2 potential energies through the diagonals, right? So, 4 potential energies along the sides minus of G M square divided by R, because distance of separation is R, plus 2 potential energies. Actually, these masses are kept separated by distance root 2 R, root 2 R. So, 2 into minus of G M square divided by root 2 into R, root 2 into R. This will give you the total potential energy of the system of charges. Total potential energy of the system of charges. Then, if a mass small m is placed over the surface of earth of radius r and its mass is me, then the potential energy can be given as minus of g me small m divided by r e. U equals minus of G M E M divided by R. This is for a mass placed over the surface of the earth. Mass placed over the surface of the earth. If suppose, instead of this arrangement, if you go for some other condition, that the mass M which is placed over the surface is taken to a height H above the earth surface, then what will be the change in potential energy? What will be the change in potential energy in this particular case? So, if the mass M placed over, this is Re, M is the mass of Earth, mass M is placed initially over here, now it has been taken to a height H, so at this point there will be a potential energy Ui. As it has been taken to this particular point, it will have some other potential energy, UF. So change in potential energy delta U equals UF minus of U1, final minus of initial, final minus of initial. I can write initial potential energy U is equal to minus of GME small m divided by RE. UF is equal to minus of GME small m divided by, it has been taken to a height h, so RE plus H. Change in potential energy delta U is equal to minus of GME small m, the entire thing is taken out, UF minus of UA, so I am doing it directly. 1 by, may I write 1 by RE minus of 1 by RE plus H, so that I can cancel out this negative sign. Right? So you will have G M E M H divided by RE into RE plus H. RE plus H. G M E M H divided by RE into RE plus H. So change in potential energy delta U is equal to G M E small m H divided by RE square into 1 plus H divided by RE. GM by RE square is small g, so G M H divided by 1 plus H divided by RE. If H is very much less than RE, then very much less than RE, then H by R will be 0, so delta U will be equal to simply mgh. Change in potential energy can be given out as mgh.